Welcome to this special presentation from Malden Economics. Joining me today are Malden Economics top analysts, along with John Malden. Together, they'll answer one of the most difficult questions all investors are facing today. How do I invest in such a volatile investing environment? First up is John Malden, internationally renowned commentator on the markets and investing. He's written several books that have made the bestseller list of the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal, and he writes the free weekly newsletter, Thoughts from the Frontline. John, it is great to be with you.
It's good to be with you. You are getting so professional at this. I mean, the networks are going to be calling.
I don't think so, but thank you. I appreciate the kindness. You raised the bar for all of us.
Oh, well, it's a good team.
It is a good team, and we're going to introduce them a little bit later. But first, let's talk about the macro stage here.
Okay.
If you would do what you do so well and just set the stage for us, and I want to talk specifically about strong dollar and cheap oil. What's causing strong dollar right now?
Well, we've been talking about divergence, and it's a divergence of monetary policy between the rest of the world and the U.S. Mm-hmm. And the U.S. keeps, the Federal Reserve, they keep teasing us that they're going to raise rates. At some point, dear God, please, they have to acknowledge that we're doing okay. They've got to begin to raise rates. They've got to start normalizing policy.
Are rates priced in? Is a rate hike priced in right now into the market?
No.
Okay.
And ironically, I think as they start raising the lower end of the rates, the higher end could be coming down because it starts pushing money into the dollar, and we get it becomes a yield curve flattener. Mm-hmm. The whole divergence thing is you've seen Europe coming in and they're now announcing QE, which is why the Swiss National Bank threw the towel. They said we can only handle so much pain, even though they're still manipulating the markets. They're still playing, the Swiss National Bank is still playing games. Then you get Kuroda coming back in and say, well, okay, I understand, but we've still got to fight deflation, which is their code word for, yeah, well, we're going to print some more because, so don't, run our currency up too much.
Is it a currency war that we're watching?
It is a currency war. I mean, this is what my book 2 years ago, I don't want to date things, but 2 years ago, we wrote a book, said
Code Red.
We're going to have currency wars. And that book is still live. You could go read it today, and it's what we're talking about is happening mm-hmm. right now. You'll see on any given week, month, quarter, currencies go up and down. But I think the long-term trend is dollar bullish for quite some time.
So what does that mean for the U.S. market and U.S. companies?
Well, U.S. companies that are international are going to be struggling. If you're a U.S. company today that you were selling something for 1,000 euros, 6 months ago, today it's 1,200. Mm-hmm. Okay, I mean your prices just went up. That's going to reduce demand. It's going to reduce your profits because they're coming back to you in euros.
Does that become a big GDP drag for the U.S.?
Not a big one, but it will become somewhat of a hit. It is deflationary. It means the Fed is looking, going, we've got to fight deflation, and you normally don't try to fight deflation by raising rates. I mean, it makes things trickier. Mm-hmm.
So how much of that impact of the strong dollar is offset, if any, by cheap oil?
I don't know that we can use the word offset. For much of the country, not Texas where we're sitting today, cheap oil is a good thing.
So we've spoken about the U.S. dollar. We've spoken about oil and energy. What else would you want an investor in 2015 to be focused on right now from the macro perspective?
I think we have to pay attention to Europe. The Greeks are trying to, get a repricing of their debt, mm-hmm. properly so. They can't pay it. So, can they pull off in Ireland by pushing it out 40 years in the front? Do they get outright forgiveness? I don't know how they do it. Merkel's saying, well, you guys can just go ahead and leave if you want to. I might have to withdraw my bearish euro call if the Greeks leave.
So that could be positive for the euro.
Actually, positive for the euro, and I think it would be positive, you know, for Europe in general, because it would also say to Spain, Italy, the others, you've got to get your act together. We're not going to bail you out. So I think we really have to pay attention to Europe. We have to pay attention to China. China is on the brink of problems. Can they buy their way out of it? Can they keep forestalling it? Maybe. But I think within the next 5 years, China finally has that hard landing.
Okay.
And the world is not ready for a 3-4% growth China. That's going to reduce the demand for commodities, the demand for everything else. So, I mean, we've got a lot of fundamental changes happening on that global macro scene.
Sure, it's a complex
It's
landscape.
A complex environment. But it's going to be a lot of tradable trends, a lot of very potentially profitable investments out there. What you don't want to do is, you know, just buy the market and just shut your eyes and pray. You actually have to be a little bit more nimble, a little bit more strategic now.
So let's move on and speak to two guys that you know very well, Tony Sagami and
Two of the
Jared
best traders
Dillon.
In the business.
Yes.
And I'm ecstatic to have them on our team. It took us a long time to get these guys.
Well, we'll move on and speak to them. John, always a pleasure to be with you. Thanks so much.
Thank you, sir.
As John just discussed, it's a real privilege to introduce my next guest. Jared Dillon is one of Wall Street's most popular commentators. He's the author of the book Street Freak, a memoir of money and madness. And he was the head of ETF trading at Lehman Brothers. He brings his cutting analysis and perceptive observations about the markets to Malden Economics each week in his free weekly letter, The Tenth Man. Jared, welcome.
Thanks, Ed.
So, Jared, you're a student of investor psychology. How does that inform how you trade?
In my experience, you know, since going back to my Lehman Brothers days, I found that the one strategy which worked for me consistently was focusing on psychology. Technical analysis works sometimes, fundamental analysis works sometimes, but being able to predict human behavior is something that you can do consistently over time in the markets, and that includes a day and age when it's dominated by algorithmic trading.
You wrote a piece a few weeks ago about the volatility of volatility. Can you explain that concept?
Well, first of all, I started my career in the options market. I was a local on the Pacific Options Exchange out in San Francisco. Mm-hmm. And I learned a lot about options. And even when I was trading ETFs at Lehman Brothers, I sat with the options trader. So I've been surrounded by volatility traders my whole life. So I've studied it a lot. And back about 10 years ago, I started to study how volatility itself behaves. And volatility actually moves around, and you can measure the volatility of volatility. Now, this was before you had options on the VIX index, and now you can measure it quite precisely. And back then, it was just a guess. But what I figured out was when vol was very high, it meant that there was a lot of stress in the markets. And even when you didn't think there was stress, and the interesting thing is that today, vol continues to be very high, telling us that there is stress in the markets, even though you might not figure that out by looking at the VIX.
Okay, so vol is high right now, but the VIX itself is still
pretty average.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Where do you see that going?
Well, it kind of depends on the macro environment. If the dollar continues to do damage to emerging markets, things of that nature, but it looks like we are in a high volatility regime.
So with that backdrop, what are your high conviction trading ideas right now? What are you trading around?
Well, I'm doing a lot of different things. I mean, you want to do things where you gain exposure to that volatility. And right now, my number one idea is Canada. I've been focusing on Canada very hard for the last 2 years. And the reason I got attracted to it was because of its housing market. Their housing market is very overpriced, the most overpriced in the world by a lot.
In the world.
So I was focusing on that exclusively. And interestingly, what's turned Canada sort of negative is the energy markets. You know, oil has gone from $100 to $40 a barrel. And suddenly, people have figured out that Canada is very negatively exposed to oil prices, which could set off a downturn in the housing market.
Canada, I'm assuming you're short across the board, essentially?
I am short the Canadian dollar, and I am short two Canadian banks. People are still not focused on this housing issue. Canadian consumers are the most indebted in the world by huge amounts.
What sort of long trades are you in right now?
I'm long India. I'm long a small cap India ETF. I am very encouraged by the political developments there mm-hmm. with Modi becoming president. People have sort of likened him to a Reagan figure in India, and I sort of agree with that. I need to do some more work on that, and it's a position that I like to grow over time. I think the China reflation story is pretty interesting. I'm starting to become interested in that. Emerging Asia in general, if you look at Indonesia, is starting to look very interesting to me.
You feel that a strong dollar isn't necessarily an obstacle to continued growth in Asia?
Well, you would think that it would be, but you know, as I start to look at the charts and I start to look at how some of these countries are behaving, I'm starting to get a little bullish anyway.
So 2014 was sort of a one trade idea, the go long market. How do you see 2015 playing out and what's different?
Well, the U.S. equities markets are a little bit overpriced. You cannot account for what the Federal Reserve is going to do. They continue to communicate through John Hilzenrath at the Wall Street Journal that they're going to raise interest rates, and then they always walk it back at the last minute. And I'm kind of in the show me phase with the Fed. You know, I'll believe the rate hike when I see it, and it keeps getting postponed further and further and further out. And in that environment, I still want to maintain upside exposure, cheap upside exposure. I don't necessarily want to be long, but I want to be exposed to that move if the Fed continues to not do its job.
Jared, I really enjoyed it. Thanks for your time.
Thanks, Ed.
My next guest is Patrick Cox, the editor of Transformational Technology Alert. A consultant for national political campaigns and Fortune 500 companies, Patrick was a longtime opinion writer for USA Today, in addition to writing for the Wall Street Journal and appearing on television networks like CNN. He's considered one of North America's leading experts on biotech. Patrick is joining me from Florida. Welcome, Patrick.
It's great to be with you, Ed.
Patrick, with your focus on early stage biotech companies, does overall market volatility really even impact your investment strategy?
Volatility is a feature, not a bug. Thousands of books have been written about the fact that volatile stocks outperform as a group non-volatile stocks. This is the nature of startup innovation companies, is that at any one time they can be down or up depending on the whims of the market, depending on thousands of other factors. But that's actually good because we know just mathematically, if you have a diversified portfolio of these startup innovative companies, you're going to outperform the general market. We can afford to have some down, we can afford to lose some, because in the long run, a group of these transformational companies is going to do better than any other kind of portfolio. Obviously, you don't want your whole savings in volatile stocks because you might need it for a medical emergency or college or whatever. But on the other hand, if you want growth, the place you go is volatile companies. On top of that, it gives you the opportunity, if you have great confidence in a technology and a company, to play those dips and rises, channel trading it's called, to leverage your ownership, to increase your ownership, and to really produce significant yields. And a lot of my readers do that very successfully.
What segment of the biotech sector has you the most excited from an investment perspective?
It's mHealth, mobile health. We're seeing Silicon Valley and the IT players come into healthcare in a big way now. And it's not just wearable devices, it's the cloud-based access to big data, your genome, your healthcare record, and everybody else is on top of that. What that gives us is the ability to think about wellness as opposed to specific diseases. As it stands right now, Big Pharma's model, the regulatory model, is dealing with diseases as they come up. The IT world is interested in wellness, that is, using this enormous tool of the cloud and all of this big data that is associated with healthcare to prevent you from getting sick in the first place. That's not really surprising if you think about the fact that there's a bunch of billionaires in Silicon Valley. Got everything they need physically and now are concentrating on the one thing that they want, and that's to live a longer, healthier life. Fortunately, they have a power base, they have the finances to fight this institutional inertia, which is keeping us from advancing faster than we are right now, and we're going to see that in a big way. This isn't to say you want to invest particularly in Google or Apple as a healthcare company. You're more interested in looking at the companies that are going to bring value to those platforms. In particular, that's genomics and regenerative medicine.
Patrick, great to see you today. Thank you.
Thank you, Ed.
My next guest is someone John Malden has known for decades. Tony Sagami has been picking stocks and making money for his subscribers for at least 20 years now. Based in Asia, no one has a better view of the incredible economic revolution sweeping Southeast Asia, China, and India. He's the editor of several publications from Malden Economics, including Yield Shark and Rational Bear. Tony, welcome.
Thank you. Happy to be here.
It's good to have you. So I know you've been very critical of the high level of the market lately, and you have been for the last several months. What's your assessment of the market today?
Well, the market is not cheap, and it's expensive by different valuation measures. You know, people get focused on the, well, at least the mass media talks about the PE being reasonably high at 18, 19 times earnings. But there's other valuation levels that are much more alarming, especially if you dig down to smaller stocks. But in general, I think the big disconnect is that Wall Street is assuming that S&P 500 earnings are going to go up by 8% in 2015. And that's a pretty optimistic view, and I just don't think it's going to happen.
You don't think earnings are going to meet expectations?
No, I think a good example is Procter & Gamble recently came out, and they reported the quarter earnings, which were pretty good, but they said 2015 is not going to be so good. They said that because of the strong U.S. dollar, they expected their revenues to drop by 5% for the year. That's the revenue side. On the profit side, they said it would drop by 12%. So either Wall Street has an over-optimistic view of what corporate America is going to do in 2015, or Procter & Gamble is this isolated island of problems that isn't going to affect the rest of the world. That's not the way it is. So really, the expectations for 2015 plus the high valuations are setting this up for some difficult times ahead.
So Procter & Gamble, they're just one example of a multinational. How does the strong dollar impact this? Is that what is causing this?
Yes. You know, the U.S. dollar was up. The dollar-weighted index, which is a trade-weighted index, it was up by 13% in 2014.
Okay.
And one of John's strongest convictions is that the dollar is going to continue to rise. But nonetheless, that strong dollar really it hurts them in two ways. First, the products are more expensive. You know, a tube of Colgate is now 13% more expensive. So maybe they buy a local brand in Germany or China or Argentina. And then also, when they get those currencies, those sales in foreign dollars, they have to convert it back to U.S. profits, and they lose there. And so it's a real problem. It's not just Procter & Gamble. McDonald's, Coca-Cola, 3M, United Technologies, Pfizer, and even Walmart said that the strong dollar is hurting their profits. So it's a widespread problem, but it's a disconnect. Wall Street hasn't admitted it yet. They still have that very positive expectations for the year. And I think that's a big disconnect, and that's why you're going to see the volatility.
Does this force you outside of the U.S. for investments?
It should force you to at least look outside the U.S. You know, it's the flip side of the same coin. You know, these other countries, like Japan, for example, Toyota is doing very well. The cars are cheaper now because of the strong dollar.
Cheaper in the U.S.
Cheaper in the U.S. And it's also helping their sales and improving their profits. As a matter of fact, Toyota said for every one yen change a weaker, they expect that to add approximately $20 million of extra profits per quarter. So we're talking about big amounts of money.
Sure. Let's talk about oil a little bit. How is cheap oil impacting your investment strategy right now?
Well, there's winners and losers from cheap oil, and we've been able to do both. You know, for example, in our publication called Rational Bear, we were ahead of the curve, and we were able to short by put options on oil services stocks. We did very, very well. On the other hand, in just one trade, we took the opposite end of that. We were long airlines, long trucking companies, long Cooper Tire. And so those companies all profited from cheaper oil. Or at the same time, in Rational Bear, we were profiting from falling oil prices on the oil providers. And so no matter which way the when there's big swings, whether it's the dollar, the markets, commodities, there's opportunities both on the long and the short side. It's just a different, same pair of pants, just different pockets.
So how are you feeling about the market in general right now? Do you believe volatility is here for an extended period of time or returning back to normal at least?
Yes, I think you've seen that so far in January. January's been a pretty volatile month. I had a conversation with my brother last week. He's just a few years away from retirement. He's a big shot at Nordstrom's. And the Dow Jones was up by 200 points on the day. And he was really happy about that because my 401k went up. You really should be worried when you see those wild positive swings. People think those are good things. But you know, the three biggest up days in the history of the stock market happened in 2008. Mm-hmm. And so you see these big, powerful up days in established, more established bear markets. So to me, it's a very big warning sign when you see those big up and big down moves. And that higher volatility is a problem, but it's also opportunity. Because in rational bear, we've been trading the VIX index. There's an ETF called the VXX.
Sure.
And we've owned it three times, just rebought it again. And every time we've done it, we've made profit by it. So volatility is a warning sign, but it's also can be your friend if you know how to harness it.
How else do you hedge your long portfolio?
Well, we look at valuations, number one. But you can do things like put options on index. There's a lot of inverse ETFs that are designed to make money when prices are falling. Mm-hmm. And the universe of inverse ETFs is really wide. It's just not indices, the major indices like the Dow and the S&P and the Russell, but you can get them on almost every commodity there is, foreign markets, volatility, and a lot of esoteric things, like oil, copper, things like that. So there's a lot of opportunity. You don't have to buy exotic futures or options to profit from downside moves. And you can either use those as a speculative tool to make profits, or if you want to do more traditional hedges against your other long positions.
I know you focus a lot on dividend paying stocks. Where do you see, or what do you see for 2015 with dividend paying stocks? Are they overpriced? Have too many investors piled into them?
Oh, they're underpriced, but a lot of people have piled into the wrong ones. Now, we go back to that issue about the strong dollar. You know, some companies with strong foreign revenues are going to have trouble. But others, especially foreign companies, are poised for growth. But, you know, if I had to make three big, bold predictions for the next 10 years, I think there's going to be three big shortages, food, water, and income. Janet Yellen and the Fed, they're telegraphing that they're going to raise rates. But, you know, I don't think they will.
You don't?
No. The rest of the world is in this giant foot race to zero, or below zero in the case of Switzerland.
Right.
And so I don't think the U.S. can raise rates in that backdrop, especially if they want to defend the dollar and do other things to keep the economy rolling. So I don't think the rates are going to go up as much as people think. Look at what the bond market's telling us. The bond market, the 30-year bond, hit an all-time low. You know, all-time. That's really saying something. So the rates are going lower and lower and lower. And I think the big mistake people are making is they're anticipating higher rates, where I think the reality is going to be lower rates. If that's the case, dividend-paying stocks that don't have a lot of strong dollar exposure are really poised for success.
So stay long on a selective basis. Look at dividend-paying stocks. Short some aspect of your portfolio, get some protection. What else would you say to an investor in 2015?
You know, short is a lot of people, when they hear short, they say, oh, that's terrible high risk. But really, you have to look in the context of portfolio insurance, the overall composition of what you're trying to do, and also reducing volatility. You know, everybody likes volatility on the upside, but people hate it on the downside.
Right.
And so this is by adding some selected shorts, options, inverse ETFs as hedges, I think you'll find that it'll reduce volatility and improve your performance. 2015, I think, is going to be back to a really roller coaster year. So you can either do nothing, but you better have a couple dozen bottles of Pepto-Bismol, or take a more active role and react to changes. You know, the buy and hold was a very successful strategy for a long time.
Right.
But buy, hold, and pray is not going to work going forward.
Okay. Tony, as always, great to see you.
Great. Let's go get some Tex-Mex tonight.
That sounds good. We're in Dallas. Why not? I hope you found real value in what you've seen here today. For everyone at Malden Economics, I'm Ed D'Agostino. Thanks for watching.
We We invite you to learn more about our premium investment services written by the analysts you just heard from. You'll see a link for each analyst below where you can learn more about their services and portfolios. Representing our best investment research, take a moment to explore how you can benefit from the research these analysts produce each month.